Hi, I'm Scott Hanselman. It's Azure Friday. We're here with Brendan Burns, and we're talking about Kubernetes. We did a video before, a little 101 on creating a Kubernetes cluster with Azure Container Service. Let's dig in a little bit more and talk about how you would use and maintain Kubernetes on Azure.
Absolutely. So I want to start. I have a little very simple Node.js application here in Visual Studio Code. Visual Studio Code has really become my like go-to. I'll close the terminal here. It's really become my go-to editor. It's really great for a bunch of different things.
Mm-hmm.
And I've taken this application and I've built a Docker container out of it, pushed that up to the Docker Hub,
mm-hmm.
And now I'm running it inside of Kubernetes. So if we go over here to the Kubernetes command line, I can say kubectl git pods. So pod is that container. It's kind of a whale joke. You know, Docker has this sort of nautical theme. So so there's my, you know, there's this container running.
Mm-hmm.
And what I've actually done here is I can say git services. And so what you'll see here is I have this simple node service
mm-hmm.
right here. And that's actually a load balancer that is load balancing traffic down onto that container. Now, there's only one of them right now, right? But what's also happened is when I created that service, it's actually integrated with Azure.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's created that external IP that you see there.
Right.
That's an Azure load balancer. That's out on the public internet. Right.
Is that a special Kubernetes brand or
no? It just calls Kubernetes calls into the Azure API to create that load balancer for you, right? So you can use the Kubernetes command line. Say I want to expose these pods to the internet,
mm-hmm.
and it will do under the hood. It'll set up the load balancer for you and just puts it out there for you to see. So it's super easy.
That's a really nice example of where like a piece of open source software and Azure Cloud like work well together and
right.
know about each other.
Exactly. No, and it has done a really good job, and I should say we've done a bunch of work to make that integration work really seamlessly.
Yeah, it's very seamless,
right?
Yeah.
Exactly, because we want people to have, we don't want to have this like weird janky, like, oh, it's like the Kubernetes native experience and then the Azure, like, no, you want to have it be the native experience.
Yeah, it doesn't
right?
feel bolted it on.
Exactly, it feels natural, and actually it feels magical at some level, right? Like you were in this world and you didn't even know it was connected to the Azure world, and suddenly it just is, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So if we go over there, I can take the IP address here.
You just hit enter.
All right. Yeah, I'm still learning. I'm still learning Bash on Windows.
Learning the dark side.
Yeah.
We'll talk later.
All right. Yeah, I'm sure I should watch more of your videos. I learn all sorts of things.
Anytime I can avoid using the mouse. Was it port 8000?
Yeah, that's right. So there's the simple node service, and I think what I want you to note is this host name that's right here.
Okay.
Right? And so
is that a generated host name?
That's a generated host name, right? And so what you'll see here, if we go back over, let's say that you know we were talking earlier about how sometimes things get busy, you know, at a service, and you need to scale up. Well, we can actually just say kubectl scale right. And so at this point, I've scaled up my deployment. Right. And so now.
So now, does that kick off a thing and it takes like 5 minutes and then the thing will scale up?
It kicks off a thing, but it doesn't take 5 minutes. So now if we go back over here, you can see pods. And there's five of them. And you can see two of them are now running. Three of them are in creation.
If you do
right?
it again.
So they'll do it again. They get in there, hopefully.
Yeah.
We'll keep our fingers crossed. So what's happening here is that that container's being pulled down over the network. So usually if it's slow, it's because
it's coming from the Docker Hub.
It's coming from the Docker Hub. It's coming down over the network onto those machines.
Okay.
So at that point, hopefully, keep my fingers crossed. The one that came up fast, I think, landed on the same machine where it had already been pulled.
Oh, interesting. Oh, right, because I'm not thinking about the underlying virtual machine.
Right, we're not really thinking about it. And the scheduler is responsible for spreading them out.
Okay.
Right, so because you want to make sure that if one machine fails or crashes or whatever.
That's a very
like,
good point.
The load gets spread around machines that doesn't.
I would not want six of these or five of these on one virtual machine.
Exactly, so right. You want to spread them out. And also because, you know, of course, you want to minimize the load on the processor. So now we're up to three.
So this one is probably on another virtual machine.
Yeah, almost certainly. And we can actually find that out. We can actually say, if we say dash O wide, what you can see here is there's the machines that they're on. And indeed, and now we're all running.
Yeah, look, they're all running. And you were right. The one that came up fast is on the same virtual machine.
Yeah, exactly. So those are on the same virtual machines. And so you can see the nodes that they're running on there.
It's kind of nicely spread out.
Right.
That's amazing, though. But you just brought up five web servers like that.
Right, exactly. And they're spread out. And the load balancer now is talking to all of them. One of the cool things that you can do here is actually I can actually run a proxy for the entire API. So let's suppose that I don't actually want to expose my service to the internet, right? It's an internal service, it's not secured, you know, but I need to poke at it for debugging reasons, for example, right? So I can actually say kubectl proxy right here. And what this is going to do is this is going to create a local running web server, and I can actually go up and I can start poking at it. So I can say 120.
So you just tunneled from your local machine?
Yeah, exactly. So I can say HTTP 127.0.0.1/, and then I have to actually walk in. So you're going to actually sort of see some of the under the covers.
Right.
So we say API v1 namespaces default services.
This is a REST front end on your.
This is a REST front end on the.
Close.
I need the port 8001.
Okay.
All right. So there's that same thing. Now it's tunneling through, right? It's not going through the public internet.
Wow.
It's tunneling down to my local machine. That means I can poke at that. I can debug it from my local machine. I can even set up, you know, run my client code on my local machine, connect through that proxy, without having to worry about the security of connecting it through the putting it on the public internet. And indeed, if we hit refresh a few times, you'll see that that host name is changing, right? We're moving between the various replicas in that service, right?
Wow.
So that's the load balancer going across all of the different replicas that we created.
So when you have this kind of control and this kind of speed, when I can bring up five of something in less than a minute, it really is up to me as the architect of the application. Like if we talk about the example in the previous introduction video, I had a products service and a shopping cart service. That might be enough.
Right.
But I could really go microservices.
Yeah.
And auth could be a thing and
exactly.
Image serving.
Yeah,
it's
totally
up to me, right?
Exactly, definitely. And I think the other thing you'll find is that over time you'll figure out where the boundaries should have been, right? And you'll split things apart, right? It's kind of like the old analogy of like not paving the sidewalks and just waiting to see where people walk. Like over time you'll see how you should split your service apart. And I think that's what we see. Maybe you start with two, and then you realize that that one piece really should be two pieces. You break it apart, you have three services, so on and so forth.
But if changing it takes a minute, then.
Exactly. No, exactly. And you can iterate through that change, right? So you don't have to just destroy a bunch of machines and create a bunch of machines in order to create the new thing. You can sort of slowly bring up the pieces that you need on the service. Right?
So I have two questions.
Sure.
How do I know that how many machines I needed?
Mm-hmm.
How do I know if my 1,000 containers have filled up those machines? So I guess I'm wondering,
how
do the containers know when I need more containers? And how does the ground beneath them know that there's not enough ground?
Yeah, so we can actually say, like, there's a command here. We can say kubectl top. What is that? So this shows we can say kubectl top node. And what this is going to do is this is actually going to tell us, right?
Oh, wow.
This is how much CPU is, you know, we're only using 2% of the CPU right now. This is how much memory we're using, 21% of the memory over here.
Mm-hmm.
So this actually gives us that view of, you know, what's the overall, if I'm a cluster administrator, what's the overall need? Because I think we really think that those two roles are going to become separate, where there's a person who's responsible for maintaining your Kubernetes cluster.
Right.
And there are the application developers who are deploying applications onto that cluster. If you're the cluster administrator, you don't care about the apps.
Mm-hmm.
You just focus on how full the machines are, and if you need to add a new machine, you slap a new machine down. And, you know, and eventually, it's going to be something where it's auto-scaled, right?
So you showed me in Azure where you made all of those different virtual machines.
Right.
But you made them all at once. You kind of had a template. I can add additional ones.
Absolutely,
right?
So you can
append them.
Exactly. So using the same Azure command line, you can scale up the cluster if you need to, you know, add in new resources because hopefully your service is growing. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
And this is telling me each of these are virtual machines?
Correct. Yeah. So this is telling you the overall usage of the virtual machine. Now I can actually flip it around and I could say top pod. And then that's going to tell me, those were machines,
and
now these are the
it.
Containers, and it's telling us how much, you know, we're not hitting that web server with any load, so it's not using any CPU really right now.
Right,
and that's
right.
Real time, right? It's not.
Right. So here's maybe a little bit of overhead, they're kind of chilling.
Yeah.
And really the node thing's doing nothing, clearly.
Yeah. Yeah, so this node CPU is like, there are things that are running that service the cluster, right? That make sure these things are healthy,
exactly.
And that deploy things, and that's.
And that's why these numbers don't represent the node app, these tiny ones do.
Yeah, exactly, right. So that's right. That's right.
And because and then this is running what operating system underneath? Is it Alpine?
This is running
Core?
Inside those containers?
Yeah.
That is actually, I don't actually
look
know.
Look at the Docker file.
Right?
What's the from?
Well, it's from Node.js, right?
From Node.js.
Whatever they use, right?
And so I think that's great.
That's
whatever.
The great thing, right? Because I was like, I don't care about OS. I just need Node, right? I don't think about necessarily the OS that's
cool.
running on.
That also makes me feel like I could go and do .NET Core.
and
Python and Node and mix and match.
Yeah,
one of my services could be in one language and one could be another.
Absolutely.
And I don't worry
even
about
operating system, right? You could say that Python one, maybe it came from Red Hat. Mm-hmm. Maybe the Node.js one is on top of Ubuntu. With Golang binaries, you don't even have really an OS image there. It's just a scratch disk, right?
Yeah.
You don't care, right? You're focusing on the application.
That's fantastic. So where do you see this going? How big can we possibly scale?
So right now, some of the biggest clusters I've heard about are in the 5,000 node range, which is probably more than most people need. Mm-hmm. And that's per region, right? So there's actually also a notion of federation. So you deploy a cluster in US West, you deploy a cluster in US East, you can actually kind of have a sort of Uber cluster that sits on top that allows you to administer both, right? And we'll spread work between those two clusters.
Is this in preview or can people use this right now?
People can use this right now. It is in preview. The Kubernetes part is in preview. Mm-hmm. Azure Container Service itself is GA. But you know, we just launched the Kubernetes part. We need to give it a little bit of a soak. But I think I anticipate it going to GA pretty soon.
So. Very cool. Thanks so much for your time.
Yeah, no problem at all. Thank you.
We're learning all about Kubernetes and containers and Azure Container Service here on Azure Friday.